Well, I'm not the beauty, I'm the refugee. Well, as she said, I'm a filmmaker, Brazilian, Swedish. I've been living in Europe for the past 20 years now. And in 1995, I hadn't been in Brazil for 4 years, so I decided to visit my family. So there I was at the airport. I saw my sister, she had dyed her hair red, and there was a woman at her side waving at me. Who was she? She started calling my name, and only then I realized she was my mother. It took me 30 seconds to recognize my own mother. She had had plastic surgery, belly, breasts, facelift, nose, and liposuction, and she didn't want to tell me because she wanted to surprise me. Well, she shocked me. If your mother has become somebody else through getting younger and you did not follow this process, it could be worse, but it's still, it's a very weird situation. But in any case, in no time, and despite all this external change, my mother was her old self again. And after not having met me for all these years, the first thing she told me was, "Your teeth are too yellow. You should bleach them." She's a dentist. Well, I know many women that have mothers like that. You know, they are always on a diet. They are always pursuing the perfect shape. They are frequently shopping for new outfits, but they are never satisfied with themselves. And the daughters get a lot of the heat. So how is my family different from that? Let's watch that.
They are now 30 altogether. Mother, sister, father, ex and new wives, uncles, aunts, and cousins. All of them operated on by my brother Sergio. I'm the only one out of the list, but they keep trying to pull me in.
Ok. Vira o rosto para o lado. A incisão é aqui.
Seu nariz não é ruim de jeito nenhum. Seu nariz é muito normal. Mas existem formas de melhorá-lo. É como a Vanessa. Vanessa tinha um nariz.
Eu acho, lá no fundo, que se o Sérgio pusesse a mão no seu nariz, ficaria mais bonito do que está.
Você sabe o que você fosse fazer? O que eu fazia? Gente. Eu injetava metacrilato no lábio, porque você puxou seu pai e tem o lábio mais fino, e eu colocava prótese de mama.
Sua sobrancelha está se tornando um pouco... Já sempre foi, mas ela está se tornando um pouco assim. Uhum. Então você poderia levantar a cauda do supercílio, que isso traz mais vivacidade ao rosto. Uhum. Enfim. E o nariz seria um afilamento da ponta, com uma pequena raspagem dessa área aqui e um pequeno fechamento da asa. Nesse nível aqui.
Uhum. Assim?
É. Você tinha peitinho muito pequeno. Ah. Acho que você poderia fazer um pouquinho mais, né? Botar um siliconinho aí e fazer um...
Aumentar?
É, aumentar um pouquinho.
Por quê?
Eu acho que o brasileiro, não sei se o europeu gosta, mas o brasileiro gosta de um peitinho para caber na mão.
Well, what my family did to me in such a bold way is exactly what the beauty industry does to women all over the world. Only they do it in a softer, quite patronizing way. They show us a brilliant skin, for instance, and they tell us ours could be the same. Or they tell us we could get thin or slimmer in 10 days, and they show a model of their choice that has this perfect slim body. They never tell us our feet or hands or nails or noses or breasts or asses are bad. They just tell us it could be better, which actually translates we are not good enough according to their standards. And instead of us getting angry at them, we are quite soothed. We say, "Oh, mommy, daddy, I will be better." And we promise ourselves we will, and by consuming their solutions. Why is that? Why do we accept the biased friendship? Why do we want to believe in this world they present us? Why do we want to be part of it? Well, let's take a closer look how their strategy works. Everybody has or has had a friend that was bullied at school for being too tall, too fat, too fast, or talking too much, or too funny, or too tough, or not sexy enough, or have small breasts, or no breasts, or big asses, or you know, you name it. I was one of those girls. At the age of 14, I was the shortest. I looked like a boy, and I had no breasts. So up to now, no D cups. And most of my friends, they had already kissed, and a few of them had already had their sexual debut, and I was still a kid playing on the streets. I turned 15, and there was no boyfriend in sight. Not that I was very worried about it, but my friends were all into it. And at that time, it all happened on Sunday afternoons in the city I come from. After sporting or sunbathing at a sports club, we would all meet at this boulevard, and it had the city's biggest and best pizzerias lined up on each side. And it would be packed with boys and girls. We were hundreds, even 1,000 on a good Sunday. And the boys would be driving cars, the girls would be walking the sidewalks, waiting for the, you know, to be seen, appreciated, chosen, and maybe even picked up by one of the boys. It sounds like a tipo zone, but it wasn't, you know. We were all from good families, and we were not looking for paid sex. We were just waiting for the boys' approval. And everybody enjoyed that. It was not working for me, though, as long as I insisted in wearing plain jeans and a t-shirt. So one Sunday, I borrowed my mother's high heels. I put on a skirt, tank top, makeup, a hairdo, and you know, the approving whistles. So the beauty trick really works. But soon I thought, what am I doing here? You know, I'm walking the sidewalks for those empty-headed boys, you know, driving their father's cars. You know, why should they approve or disapprove of us? Why should I be happy or feel miserable because of their judgments? And besides, they, like the beauty industry, they would see us as body parts. They would judge and compare our asses, our breasts, our noses, you know, and the glosses that we were supposed to enjoy reading, they would see our bodies as artifacts, as an industrial piece of work to be adjusted and you know, improved for the boys' approval. I mean, if you accept that, what you are actually doing is that you're turning yourself, the subject of your own life, into an object to be controlled, adjusted, and approved of by somebody else. Now, today they tell us that our body belongs to us. We do it for our own pleasure. Let's watch that.
My father has been living with Bia for some years now. She's 26 years younger than him, which makes her 4 years older than me.
Mas e se a Bia fosse da sua idade? Você casaria com uma mulher mais velha?
Não.
Da sua idade?
Não, eu tive várias propostas enquanto estava solteira e eu não quis, não.
Por quê?
Porque eu não tinha tesão nela.
Hã?
Não tinha tesão nela.
Mas então você acha que o ponto principal é o sexo? É a atração.
Mas é que a atração tem que vir junto com outras coisas, né?
Uhum.
A independência econômica, a inteligência, a Bia tem tudo isso. É inteligente, tem independência econômica.
Mas por que você não pode se sentir atraído? Por que você não se sente atraído por uma mulher mais velha?
Ah, não sinto, porque é do homem, é do macho. O macho não tem atração por mulher velha, não. Nenhum homem tem.
Well, we all want beauty, but nobody knows what it is. And we are told that human beings have always been busy with beauty even the so-called primitive cultures. The French philosopher Michel Foucault, he said that power has always been busy with our bodies. Power wants to discipline our body, they train it, they torture it, they force it into participating in ceremonies, they make it perform certain tasks. He's talking about institutions like schools, asylums, prisons, the military, you know, Abu Ghraib, Guantanamo. And even nowadays at our own home, you know, in front of TV or behind our computers. The so-called primitive societies have indeed, or would indeed, use tattoos, wigs, you know, makeup, and other devices for the embellishment of the body. But beauty has always, in every society and culture, been connected to power or to access to power. It is a dividing mark or sign. To have certain features according to certain parameters or parameters that change with time has always been connected to social ranking. But how much does it cost?
Afinei a cintura, fiz uma lipo aqui, levantei esse peito, botei prótese, fiz uma lipo aqui nas costas, aqui debaixo do braço, e a gordura que o senhor disse tudo já estou aqui. Agora está precisando fazer lift aqui.
Oh, this is my mother, she's 73, and luckily my brother is a plastic surgeon, so she doesn't have to pay for all this. But to me, the cost was a serious depression. To women in Argentina, to one in four women in Argentina, the cost is anorexia, and at an increasingly younger age, girls in the age between 8 and 10 are feeling the pressure to match some beauty ideal. In Venezuela, beauty isn't something that you are necessarily born with. It is a pursuit that has evolved into an industry that has become a national obsession. In Italy, Berlusconi has turned female beauty into the number one asset to get into his parliament with, you know, catastrophic results as we are all witnessing. In Brazil, girls have plastic surgery at the age of 15. Here in the Netherlands, the amount of girls in the ages between 15 and 19 suffering from eating disorders has doubled in the past 25 years. So the costs are pretty high. You know, last week in South Korea, a young model died of a face operation. It was not her first, and she's not the only one. There is a long list of countries, China, Iran, Mexico, the US, where beauty is threatening to become a national problem. Now, I'm sure there are many of us here today who feel that it does not cost them anything. Let's take a look at it. You know, this is like a basic beauty kit. The prices are average in euros. So that means you can find cheaper ones, but surely more expensive ones in the market. If we renew this kit four times a year for every season, it sums up to 2,700, which makes 225 euros a month. 30 minutes per day in front of the mirror, 7 days a week, makes 14 hours a month, which is 2 working days a month. For this amount of money and time per month, we'll be looking almost as good as the models in the magazines. And we are worth it, right? L'Oreal is surely cashing on that. But what percentage of the women in the world can live up to this? We live in the West in a system where the capital, or the power, if you will, are trying to convince us that our lives lie entirely in our hands. They tell us they are actually shifting a great deal of their responsibility. The big companies, you know, the corporations, the banks, the government even, are shifting their responsibility to the individual level. If we fail, it's all our own fault. There are a number of people and a number of occupations that feel really good in such a competitive surrounding, but there are other occupations and other people that feel better in a slower, safer environment, like artists, writers, children, just to name a few. Meritocracy, that system that tells us that that you will be rewarded for what you do, and if you do your best, it will be all right, doesn't turn out true, to be true in all cases. In fact, far from it. And that generates a lot of frustration. But the beauty industry thrives in that frustration. If you're not feeling good, if you're not satisfied with yourself, they will present you a number of solutions to improve your life. All their solutions are for sale and for quite a lot of money, as we've seen. Beauty is truth, according to Saint Augustinus. But there is no truth in the glosses. All models are photoshopped. To want to obtain beauty as passively as they want us to is quite immoral if you take a closer look at it. Beauty is interaction. When you look at something or someone and it makes you feel good, that's beauty. But most women I know, they feel quite bad looking at the magazines because they know they'll never achieve that. When those ideals of beauty, you know, and all that it costs and all the psychological problems and the time it costs, when all of that is standing in the way of the full realization of ourselves as human beings, then yes, we can say no to a beauty industry and to a media that rather have us imprisoned in our bodies than in control of it. The most important lesson feminism has taught us is solidarity, because just a while ago, we were, and in many parts of the world, we still are the underdogs. So I have a fantasy. All highly educated women in the world is poor, queer, black, Muslim, migrant. That would be the utmost starting point for a peaceful revolution that would lessen our frustration of being imperfect. In fact, we would allow diversity. We would stop letting our idea of ourselves be shattered into small pieces of body parts. We would finally see ourselves as a whole being, empowered, and we would be sharing this power, which is the best way to feel good and contribute to a better world. Thank you very much.